Now, yes, okay. So good afternoon. So I welcome you all for this CE5720 stability of structures course. See, basically, you know, this course was, if you see the official thing, the course was supposed to be taken by Professor Arul Jayachandran, you know. So I was supposed to take some other course, but since now, you know, this semester, this course is online, right? So he backed up actually, okay. So he told on online mode, he is unable to teach this course. So finally, you know, it came to me itself, okay, the stability. So now this course, you know, as already I told you, we'll be using this Microsoft Teams itself. All the videos will be recorded, okay? So if you are not able to follow also, you can see in Microsoft Teams. It will be stored in Microsoft Teams. You can go back and you can see this itself, okay? And then, you know, but only thing, please mind is, you know, I am also a little bit new for this online kind of a thing, okay? So I will be using this Teams and that, I think Microsoft, you know, whiteboard kind of a thing. So my handwriting is not, you know, in board I can write nicely, but this is glass, you know, a little bit, you know, things may happen, but, you know, I think you will be able to understand. Okay. So now I will just share my screen. Okay. To just have this one. So you are able to see my screen, right? You are able to see, no? The screen is there, right? That whiteboard.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes. Okay, fine. So now, as already I told you, so this course, you know, I will just rotate it. Okay. Now, so this course, as already I told you, so this is, you know, CE, you know, 5720. I think the thickness is high. No. So stability. Okay. Of structures. Okay. So now coming to this syllabus for this course, say, okay. So already online, you know, the syllabus is already available, but I will just brief you. Okay. So what I will be covering in this course itself. Okay. So we will start first thing with columns. Okay. So in this columns, say, we will see how to obtain the stability by three methods actually. One is, you know, equilibrium kind of a methods. Then we also will see energy methods, okay? So how to use energy method, like you see the principle of potential energy, strain energy kind of a thing to obtain this buckling load, we will see this one. Then we also will see this numerical methods also, okay? So like, you know, you can use FEM or finite difference approaches to obtain this, you know, this stability. So all these three we will cover in this first unit kind of a thing. Then the next one, you see, we also will go for, you see, the frames actually, okay? So for pin jointed or rigid jointed frames, you know, in the columns existing in a multi-story building. So how do we obtain these type of a thing? So this also we will discuss. Then we also will discuss about beam columns kind of a thing, okay? So this here we will see the matrix methods and others also. Then, you know, we will go to this torsional buckling actually, okay? So this torsional buckling is, you know, is a very important for, you know, thin walled structures essentially, okay? So like channel sections in your steel design, you would have used, so thin walled steel, say, okay? So this torsional buckling is a very important phenomenon. So this also we will see, okay? So then, you know, we also will go to, you see, the buckling of beams, okay? So now in beams also, you would have seen in your steel course, that is CA3050, that lateral torsion buckling. So a beam also can buckle actually, okay? So in the code book, there are some formulas that has been given for lateral torsion buckling. So now in your undergraduate, you know, we don't teach how those formulas have been obtained. But now here we will do a detailed derivation, you know, how that formula has been obtained in the codes, you know, for this lateral torsion buckling of beams, okay? So now after this, say, okay, so we will move to this, you know, plate buckling actually. So this also is a very important phenomenon, essential in steel structures, even in concrete also, you know, it's a very fundamental kind of a thing. Then we will see this shell structures also, okay? So how shells also will buckle and others. Then we will also move towards arches. then rings actually, okay, buckling of rings, arches, because nowadays arch bridges are very common in Himalayas, you know, when they, you cannot put any pillar or, you know, in the river itself. So now arches also will be under compression, so there is a chance of buckling of these arches. So here arches also, they can have, you can have a lateral torsion buckling, many complicated things will be there. So this also we will see here. And finally, say, okay, the last topic will be on dynamic stability, okay. So this is also a very, you know, the important thing in dynamics, like, you know, in the column you would have seen, when a column is subjected to load P, say, if it is a function of time actual, okay, so what is going to happen here? So now in your dynamics, you would have studied resonance here. So here you will get, you know, a very important thing. One is, you know, parametric resonance will come into picture, okay. So this is a very, very, you know, important thing when you design, you know, for dynamic loads, like the vehicular loads and other things. Then one more important thing is this flutter actually, okay. So these two things we will cover in our, you know, the course. So you can see, so almost, you know, so we have something like, you know, 8 units are there, starting with columns, frames, beam columns, torsional buckling, then lateral torsion, then plate buckling, shells, arches, rings, then finally we end up with this dynamic stability, okay. And now I just wanted to mention that this course is a pure, you know, analysis kind of a course, okay. So we are not going to do any design kind of a thing. So it is a basically, you know, a pure analysis kind of a thing. So you will be, you know, mathematical derivations will be there, you know, all those, you know, things will be there in this course itself, okay. And now the prerequisites, say, for this course. Of course, there is no prerequisite is required for this course, but you know, if you are good in mathematics, essentially ODE, you know, PDE, how you can solve these methods, so it will be useful actually, okay. So you can easily, you know, follow this course, and you know, you can do, you know, it is very easy actually, okay. So if you don't have a background, most of you would have taken in your UG the coursework related to calculus and other, that itself is sufficient. But you just, you know, if you can go through all those fundamental things, it will be useful for this course, okay. And now coming to this textbooks, say, okay. So there are, you know, excellent textbooks are there in structural stability, but I will be closely following, and this is online teaching, right. So one textbook, I will follow the derivations, you know, so that it will be easy for all of us, okay. So when the best book is, you know, we will follow this Chajes book actually, okay. So this is a book. So principles of, you know, structural stability. Okay. So this textbook is already, you know, available online. You can download and then, you know, you can follow this textbook. If you don't have also, we will send it in WhatsApp or, you know, by email. Okay. The next book for dynamic stability, say, we will be following is a bulletin. Okay. So this will be on dynamic stability, because most of the textbooks, they don't cover this dynamic stability. It is available only in this Russian book actually, okay, dynamic stability. And then apart from this, we also have some type of, you know, reference books, okay. So these are, you know, we have like, so Timoshenko's classical book is there, okay, Theory of Elastic Stability, okay. So Timoshenko and Gere. So elastic stability is there, okay, one textbook, Theory of Elastic Stability. So you can also go through this book now. And you know, we also will be having this you know, Bazant book also is there, which is a huge you know, a volume, okay. Bazant and I think Sidolin. So this is also on stability of structures, okay. So these are our reference book. Apart from that, I think one Chinese other book is there, I forgot right now, but that also, you see, we will be following as far as this course is concerned, okay. And all the textbooks are available, you see, online. So you can, PDFs are available, you know, you, anybody, I think we will send it to you in WhatsApp or maybe by email, you see, the TAs will send you, okay. So these textbooks. And now coming to this evaluation, so we will be having, you see, quiz one, okay. Then we will have quiz two, okay. Then we also will have this end semester also, okay. So we will follow like quiz one, you see, 15% weightage, then this is also 15%, then end sem will be, you see, the 40% kind of a thing. Then we have assignments and you know, tutorials kind of a thing, okay. So where you have to solve something and you have to submit, so the remaining marks, so 40 plus 30, so 30% actually, okay. will go towards assignments and tutorials. So maybe, you know, 4 or 5 assignments or maybe tutorials, you know, you may have to write some small programs or something like that to estimate this buckling kind of a thing. Okay. So this is, you know, the overall things about our course. Okay. So now if you have any questions in this, you can ask now. Okay. So if you have any questions on the syllabus and, you know, on the textbooks and the evaluation procedure, you can ask me. So if things are fine, then we will proceed.
Sir, quizzes and end semesters will be take home, like normally it is happening now.
Yes, take home. It's like an open book exam kind of a thing. Okay. And maybe sometimes, you know, some type of what you can say is, you know, like you have, right, that Google Forms. See, some small, you know, we set a time, you see, morning 9 o'clock, we share the sheet, you know, and maybe within 1 hour or something, you know, some small quizzes kind of a thing also we can conduct. I don't have idea right now, okay? Because, you know, our institute says, you know, end sem, you can come back, something, you know, they are doing, I think, TCS, they're talking with TCS to do online, something they are doing up, okay? I am not clear, but as far as I am concerned, I think open book is the best, okay? And please be no. Here the most important thing is honesty. You know, I can't monitor each and every one of you. You followed, right? Whatever you send by email, we take it official. We give the grades based on that. Okay. So you know, some copying and others. You know, we can't check each and everything. So it's up to you actually. If you are honest, I hope all of you are fine. Then you know, it's fine. Okay. I think this clear, right?
Yes, sir.
Hello, tell me once again.
Sir, any softwares we have to install before?
No softwares, you know. No, what you do is maybe MATLAB, I don't know how many have you access for this MATLAB. Maybe some small codes you may have to write. Okay.
Sir, MATLAB can be accessed online, sir, on their website.
Yes,
IIT Madras has subscription, so without installing we can.
Yes. So you may have to write some small MATLAB programs, okay? Like when it comes to frames, we discussed it, some numerical methods, a finite difference or something, or, you know, you may have to write some small codes only, okay, to find out this stability issues. So is it fine now? So all are fine, right? So the syllabus and these things are fine, right? So I think, you know, we can go ahead, okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so now you have seen, right? So my this whiteboard you are seeing, no? That everything. Okay. So now, you know, I think I will just erase this. So this is our syllabus. Okay. So now I say coming to our, you know, I will just give a brief introduction for this class and then we can do it in detail, you know, later on. In the next classes. So now I see to have introductions. All of you already know this buckling. Okay. So all of you have studied this buckling in your undergraduate courses. Okay. In mechanics of materials, you know, or maybe strength of materials or something. You people have already been exposed. What's happening? Okay. So now, you know, this, but in undergraduate courses, you followed, right? So what you would have seen is, you know, whenever this word buckling, stability comes to say. See, what's happening? My voice is,
Maybe someone needs to mute.
Okay, I think, okay. So now in your undergraduate, say. I think somebody has to mute, you know. Please mute your mics. I think C19, who is that one? No, all have now. Okay, fine. Muted. No. Okay. Now, buckling means, you know, an undergraduate, you see, buckling, the word comes as a stability or something. Obviously, you see, all your mind will go towards columns. Immediately, you follow, right? Whenever this mind, you know, buckling word comes means it, you know, it is like a synonyms are something with columns itself, okay? The slenderness ratio, you all would have seen here. But now this you have to remove from your mind actually. Okay. So now when buckling can happen, you see, it is not essential in columns. Any structural member, say. Okay. So it can be not only a column, it can be a beam, or it can be, you know, frame or whatever it is there. It can be even a, you know, torsion, it can be anything. So any structural member, say, under compression. Okay. So under compression, you know, it will buckle. That's it actually. So which structural member will buckle means, you know, any structural member subjected to compression means, you know, there is a chance of buckling actually. Okay. So this is the most, you know, the important thing. So from your mind, you know, you people have to remove that, you know, buckling is not synonymous to columns. Buckling is synonymous to all structural members, you know. Wherever you see a compression, buckling can happen. Even in simply, even in a bending of a beam, say, okay. So like, you know, you would have studied, you followed, right? Whenever there is a load is here. So all of you know, right? So you, the bending stress distribution, you see, it will be something like this. So top fibers will be in compression, bottom one will be in tension. So now the top fibers, say, whichever is in the compression side, there is a chance of, you see, buckling. So even a beam can also buckle actually. And no need to tell about arches. Arches, essentially, you see, you have this arch action. There's a compression kind of a thing. So it also can buckle. So rings, anything, any load or whatever, you know, there is a chance of buckling actually. Okay. So any structure can buckle in reality. Okay. And now generally, you see, in failure, say, okay. So in our structures, generally, failure means, you know, two types of failures are there. One is what we call as, you see, material failure. Okay. So material failure means, you know, your sigma, whatever stresses, you know, if they are greater than your sigma y or maybe ultimate or whatever, so we call as material failure. Now other one is, you see, this geometric failure kind of a thing, so which comes under, you know, this stability. Okay, so this is the most, you know, the important thing. So now in this course, you know, our definition of failure means, you see, this is a geometric failure. We are not interested in the cases where, you know, sigma greater than sigma y star. So that anyway, you know, you people have studied in other courses. So that is not very important for us. So what is more important for us is this geometric failure. Okay. And now coming to this, the most important thing in this buckling, say, the most important word is, you know, the stable equilibrium. Okay. Now, all of you know this equilibrium, you know, but stable equilibrium, you know, is the word which you should know in buckling actually. Okay, this is a very important word in buckling here. So now, you know, most of you know, right? And what do you mean by equilibrium? Nah. See, generally, equilibrium means, you know, in our structural engineering or any mechanics. So equilibrium means, you know, your right hand side should be same as, you know, left hand side kind of a thing actual. Okay. So you have forces, you have acceleration here or something like that. So both of them are same. But now in equilibrium, we do like this. But now what do you mean by stable equilibrium? So when you word use stable equilibrium, so then you can have unstable equilibrium, you can have neutral equilibrium also. So this is a famous figure, you know, all of you know these things, you would have seen in your thing. So three, you know, they do like this. Yeah. So then you see you have, okay. So if you put a ball here, say, okay, on this one, so you can say, so now here, you know, this is what we call as a stable equilibrium kind of a thing. Now this is unstable. This is, you know, neutral kind of a case. Okay. So now a stable equilibrium means if you see this ball here. So now if you give a small perturbation actually. Okay. So if you give some small perturbation here. So this ball, what happens? You follow, right? It goes this way or this way. But after some time, you know, it comes back to rest actually. Okay. So this is what we call as a stable equilibrium. Now unstable means if you give some small, you know, deformation here, say small perturbation here, this cannot go back, come back to its original position. So which we call this as unstable equilibrium. And now this neutral equilibrium, say. So here what is happening is, you know, you have this ball, if you give a small deformation, say, okay, so it can go this side or this side, it is in equilibrium, it is not a divergence or something like that, but, you know, it will, but you, it cannot come back to its original position, actually. So this we call as, you see, neutral equilibrium. So this case is something like, you know, diverging, actually, okay, and this is, you know, converging kind of a thing. Yeah, you know, it converges, okay, after our English model. Now this is, you know, it is like a neutral kind of a case, this third one, okay. So neither stable nor unstable, it is in between these two cases. So this is, so the stable equilibrium is, you know, this kind of a case actually. So in structural engineering, say, we want our structures to be in equilibrium, not only in equilibrium, we also want them to be in stable equilibrium. So then if it is not in the stable equilibrium, say, then there is a chance of, you see, this geometric failure, actually, the buckling failure. Now, generally, equilibrium, you know, means, you see, this material failure, that sigma greater than sigma y star is equilibrium kind of a thing, but stable is related to this geometric failure kind of a thing, okay? Here, if you can also say that, you know, if you give analogy to a column, say, okay, that simply supported or, you know, whatever things are there. So if you take a column, you know, subjected to this axial load, say P, and now, you know, if you give analogy, so now this P, say, okay, so when P is very, so when you take a column, when P is very small, okay, is small, or, you know, your P is less than, you see, your PCR kind of a thing, that is your pi square EI by L square, so the column will be in stable equilibrium, okay, because the load is very small, less than your PCR stable equilibrium. Now, when P, say, if it is greater than PCR, so when you apply the load is more than the critical buckling load, the column automatically, you see, gives up and it buckles. So the column will be in, you see, the unstable equilibrium kind of a thing. Now, when P is equal to PCRs, exactly, you know, the critical buckling load, the column, it is basically, you know, it is at a neutral equilibrium. So it can go this way or it can go that way itself. So generally, you know, in structures, you know, like, you know, we have said stable, unstable or neutral. But when you see the columns, a column or any structure, when the loads are very small, it will be in stable equilibrium. When the load is extremely high, more than this PCR, it will be in unstable equilibrium. When P is equal to PCR, say, it comes to, you followed it, this neutral equilibrium kind of a thing. So these are most, you know, the important. So what I would say is the columns, say, okay, the column or any structure, it goes through, you know, all three states actually, okay, in during buckling. All these, the three states. And generally, buckling load we calculate at neutral equilibrium. Okay, so to find out PCR, say, when exactly P is equal to PCR, your column will be in at a transition stage, actually. That is from stable to unstable kind of a thing. So this case, you see, we call them as, you know, the neutral equilibrium kind of a thing. Okay, and now coming to this column, say, simply supported or whatever, all of you know this, how do you calculate buckling load, you know, you would have seen in your undergraduate kind of a thing. So we use this simple bending formula. Okay, the plane sections remain plane, you would have heard, right, in your UG. So this formula we use, you know, M by I is equal to, you know, that sigma by Y is equal to EI by R. So we use this M is equal to, you know, EI by R. Okay, where E is Young's modulus, I is the moment of inertia, and R is your radius of curvature. So now I see, so if you write this expression, said the how do you calculate radius of curvature? You know that formula which comes from calculus. So that is, you know, d square y by, you see, dx square divided by, you see. So this is the original expression for radius of curvature, dy by dx whole square and to the power of, you see, 3 by 2. So this is your radius of curvature. That's the original definition. But generally, you know, you can also write this expression as, you know, EI y double dash. By 1 plus, you see, y dash. If you write in terms of, you know, derivative, so 3 by 2. So this is expression for, you see, the radius of curvature. Okay. So generally in your undergraduate, say, what we do is, if the slope is very small, okay, so if the slope is small, say, that is your y dash is very, very small, so what we do is we neglect this the slope actually. Now you follow, or if you try to expand this in terms of a Taylor series, say, okay, you can also write like this, that is EI y double dash, yeah, so 1 minus 3 by 2, so y dash square plus 3 by 2 and see the 5 by 4 kind of a thing, y dash to the power of 4 plus dash. So this is, you see, the original Taylor series expansion for this one. So now in your undergraduate course, what to do is when the slope is very small, say, okay, so if the slope is, you know, order of 10 to the power of minus 3, for example, so 10 to the power of minus 3 square actually. So the second term becomes 10 to the power of minus 6 and a higher terms, say, so 10 to the power of minus 3 to the power of 4 means, you know, minus 12 kind of a thing. In the higher order terms can be, you see, neglected kind of a thing. So we include only the first term, you know, so this becomes, you know, EIY double dash actually. Okay, so this is your the bend buckling equation, or anyway, the same simple bending formula itself. So this is how we obtain here. So we write our equation like, but now this type of you can neglect slope for, you know, our special structure, like in civil engineering, say. So we don't allow the structures, you know, to be, you know, more slope or something like that. So once it goes to something, we you know, say that the structure has collapsed or something like that, we do. But nowadays, you know, when special materials have come, like meta materials, you know, many type of variety materials, where, you know, the slope can be, you know, extremely high. So when the slope is extremely high, say, okay, so then what happens is, you know, you can't neglect this y dash. You know, so you obviously, you see, it can, it has to be, you know, you have to include in the calculations. One second. Hello. Class la unnan sir. Okay. So now for this y dash, you can neglect for, you know, special cases. Okay, for civil engineering, it is perfectly fine. But when you're talking about, you know, aerospace or other type of structures where, you know, the large slopes, where you can't neglect, they also will be extremely high, then, you know, you have to include that also into our calculations. Okay, so now we will see later after some two or three classes, what is the effect of, you know, including these higher order terms also in calculating our buckling loads. Okay, so this also we are going to see. So now I see, so in your undergraduate, so this is the equation which you have written. So now if you have a column, you see, so this column itself for the load, you know, so if this is your P, say, so what we do is, I think I can draw here. Okay, so we say that, you know, so this is a simply supported column kind of a thing. So this is a P. So what we do is, you know, at this buckling, say, so the this becomes like this. So this deflection is y, okay. So we write, and this is your, you know, y, and this is your x axis, say, okay. So now we write, you see, so m is equal to, you know, vi y double dash. So we write this as, you see, minus p times y, the bending moment. So our buckling equation becomes, you know, ei y double dash plus py is equal to zero, actually. Or you can also write this expression as, you say, y double dash plus p by ei into y is equal to zero. So this is our expression. So now this is basically, you see, a second order ODE, ordinary differential equation. So order is 2 and degree is 1. So of this ordinary differential equation. So now you see, so this has to be solved. So now we solve, you see, like this. So you all of you are very familiar. So we write as, you know, some k square y is equal to zero kind of thing, or, you know, we substitute actually, okay, some y is equal to, you know, e to the power of kx kind of a thing. So you substitute in this ODE. Yeah, in the ordinary differential equation. So you have, you know, k square e to the power of kx plus, you know, the k square e to the power of mx or whatever, this will be zero. Oh, sorry, this, I think I made a mistake here. No. So y is equal to, you see, so you substitute y is equal to mx, this is our solution. So if you substitute, say, okay, so m square, you know, e to the power of mx plus k square e to the power of mx is equal to zero. So you have m square plus k square e to the power of mx is equal to zero. So now there are, you know, so if e to the power of mx is zero, then this is a trivial solution. So for non-trivial solutions, say, so this m has to be equal, same as the k square. So this becomes ik kind of a thing. So your y is equal to, say, c1 e to the power of, you see, ik x plus c2 e to the power of, you see, minus ik x kind of a thing. And r, if you write, if you expand, so e to the power of I theta in terms of sine and cos, you can write this as, you know, a sine kx plus, you know, the b cos, say, kx kind of a thing. So now to find out these two constants, say, okay, so we do this boundary condition. So that is y is equal to 0 at x is equal to 0. Then you see y is equal to 0 at x is equal to l also. Okay, so using these two boundary conditions, so finally, you see, you solve this equation, and finally, you see, you get, like, you know, sine kl is equal to 0. So this can happen when kl is equal to n times pi, then, you know, your p. So this becomes, you see, n square pi square, you know, ei by, you see, l square kind of a thing. and your buckling modes, y is, you know, a sine, you see, n phi x by n. So this is your deflection shape. Now for n is equal to 1, okay, so you have your PCR is equal to, you see, pi square EI by, you see, L square. So this is how, you see, we calculate, you know, for the buckling load for a column, which all of you know from your undergraduates, okay, pi square EI by L square. So now here the most important thing is the observations. So in this derivation, if you see, there are very, very interesting things, you know, in our, if you see this derivation, okay, the most important observations, okay. Now the first thing, say, you can see here, this buckling problem, okay. So this buckling problem, if you see carefully the derivation, say, okay, that is why it's, you have, you know, sine kl is equal to zero kind of a thing, you have a sine kl kind of a thing. So now to have a non-trivial solution, say, okay, so we do kl is equal to n pi and then we obtain this one. So if you see this carefully, mathematically speaking, so this buckling is essentially, you see, an eigenvalue problem, okay. So this is a continuous eigenvalue problem because it's a continuous, mode shapes are all continuous. So now your eigenvalue, say, so this gives you the buckling load, whereas your eigenvector, okay, so this gives you the deformed shape or the buckling shape or whatever, you see, how this is going to define. So this is the most important observation which you can make from this derivation, okay. Now the second important observation, say, from this is basically it is a, you know, a linear problem. Essentially we have ignored all the non-linearities here, okay, it's a linear ODE, and then you see you followed, right? But generally in mathematics, you know, all of you know that if it is a linear equation, generally, you see, so we said that for linear equation, how many solutions will be there? There is only one solution will be there for a linear equation, say. But now in the buckling, say, the problem is, you followed, right? What we have here is, in the although the problem is a linear problem, you know, but the solutions are many. So these are very important observations because there are several buckling loads, you know, like, you know, n square pi square ei by l square. So n is equal to 1, n is equal to 2, n is equal to 3, n is equal to 4. You have infinite solutions, actually. So this is a very, very, you know, peculiar kind of a thing. So there is a, for a linear problem, say, generally we don't have many solutions. We have only one solution for linear problem, but buckling is a special problem where the problem is linear, but solutions are too many or infinite kind of a solutions we have. So this is also one very, you know, the important kind of a thing. And now, you know, the other case is, you know, when you plot load versus deformation, okay, so load is here and the deflection, say, is on your x-axis. So now when P is less than PCR, say, okay, so the curve is like this. So this is your, you see, PCR. So now what it says is, you know, when P is less than, you see, PCR, say, so deflection is zero. You follow, this is a zero in this derivation. But when P greater than PCR, deflection, you know, it becomes, you see, very large, or you follow, right? It is infinite, you know, kind of a thing. So this also, you know, is a very, very, you know, important problem, actually, okay? And now, so the PCR, say, is basically defined as, you know, it is the smallest load. So it is basically a smallest load at which, you know, neutral equilibrium is possible. Neutral equilibrium, you see, is possible. So this is what we call as, you see, PCR. So now we can have a better definition of, you see, the critical buckling load. So critical buckling load, the definition is, it is basically a smallest load at which, you see, neutral equilibrium, you see, is a possible kind of a thing. Or this PCR, say, is essentially, it's a transition, actually. It is like, you see, a transition kind of a thing from stable to unstable. Okay, so this is the most, you know, the important observation which you can make out from this derivation. Okay, now another derivative, another important thing is here. See, generally here, if you see the column, say, okay, where is our column? No. So this is our column here. So now column is, you know, you have applied, you know, the axial load. So generally, you know, we all know that when you apply axial load, say, deformation also has to be axial. Okay, so if it is a compression means, you know, you should have, you know, the length of the column should decrease or whatever this one. So axial deformation also this one. But surprisingly, what happens in buckling is, you know, the axial deformation doesn't enter your derivations actually. Okay, this is a very, very important thing. So axial deformation, say, that is, you know, axial deformation. It is not in the solutions. It doesn't enter our, the final, the solutions kind of a thing. So this also is a very, very, you know, important thing actually. Okay. Now another thing, you see, the question comes to everybody is why columns, you know, buckle. Okay. This also is a very, you know, the important thing. Now see why the columns, the buckle. Can anybody answer this one? See, all of you, please, you can answer, right? Why do columns buckle?
Basically, we have actually, because of the reason that we have already present deformation.
There is no deformation. The column is perfectly straight, no imperfections, nothing. Load is also perfectly centroid, everything is fine, but still column buckles. Why? How do you, you have to give a nice reason for this.
Sir, the energy required to compress this is higher than the energy required to make it laterally buckle.
Excellent. Hello, who is this? Who just told?
Utkarsh here, sir. Utkarsh, my name is Utkarsh.
Okay, very good. So I think it's a perfectly fine. Okay. So as he's rightly told, you can answer this question by, in terms of energy. Okay. So the energy, so whenever you apply a load on a column, say, okay. So the axial load, there are two ways are there for this thing. The column, what can happen is it can shorten its length. Okay. Like you apply the load here. So this portion, say, it can shorten its length by decreasing its, the length of the column. Or it can even, if you draw this one, say, it can even shorten this by, bending kind of a thing also, the laterally. So the load is applied, here itself. So now if you calculate the energy here, say, about axial deformation and energy for bending, okay, for this lateral kind of a thing. So now you followed, right? So now if energy for bending, if it is less than, say, okay, this is for axial, so when this is more than this, obviously, you see the column, the buckles. So this is the reason why the column, the buckles. Okay. So this is the main reason. So energy, if you try to calculate in axial deformation, and energy, if you calculate bending, both delta, for the same change in length or something like that. So if whichever energy is low, say, so column will go into that type of a thing. Okay. So this is a very important thing in our derivations. Okay. So to just summarize, say, please here. So generally, observe buckling is basically an eigenvalue problem. It's a continuous eigenvalue problem. We say eigenvalue is the load and eigenvectors are the deformed shapes. Then the most important observation is it is a linear problem, but solutions are too many actually. Okay, this is a very important thing. And then what definition of buckling load is, if P is less than PCR, deflection is zero, the lateral deflection. And P, if it is more than PCR, so deflection becomes infinite or something like that. So now PCR is the smallest load at which, the neutral equilibrium is possible. And PCR generally, the column is, it is like a transition from stable to unstable kind of a thing. And then axial deformation doesn't enter your solutions. In the entire derivation, no way, we get the, the axial deformation. And now the column buckle, the reason is, energy in axial is much, much higher than energy in bending. So obviously, it chooses this easy way. So that is why, the column buckles actually. Okay. So these are the very, very, the important points, which you can make out from this derivation. So if all of you have any questions, you can ask on this thing now itself, if any of you have any doubts.
Sir, can you draw a typical energy diagram deformation versus energy?
Deformation versus energy. Okay, so we will go through that one, okay, after some time. Okay, we will show you, because we have to derive the, because when, see, when we go towards large deflections, as already I told you, right, y double dash, y dash, we are neglecting. So we will do a derivation there. Okay, the energy. You have to just wait for two more classes, okay, where we will do the exam. Okay,
Sir, I was like, this VCR is a point of unstable equilibrium, right?
No, it's not a point of unstable equilibrium. When P is equal to PCR, it is basically a transition. It can go this way or it can go that way.
Yes, sir. So just a little bit more increase the load will create a large deflection, right?
Yes, slight perturbation. It is basically a transition period, okay, between stable and non-stable.
Okay.
So this energy we will calculate, okay, because you know, it is anyway in the derivation, it is there.
Hello.
Please tell me.
So the thing is, in the derivation, we are taking only single term in the radius of gyration calculation. So basically, we are underestimating the displacement response. So as per the theory we are adopting to analyze the buckling load of the structure, are we basically overestimating the force response here?
Okay, that is, you mean the Taylor series, right?
Yes, sir.
In the Taylor series, we have ignored that also, you know, we will do the derivation. That's what I told, no? If you include the next higher order terms, to say, how much it will vary.
Okay.
We will see that. That's a large deflection. See, the problem is, as already I told, in civil engineering, so generally in our structures, as rightly you pointed out, you may be overestimating all. It's like a, conservative kind of a thing. But when you do that one, there are some chances are there. Okay, and sometimes, you know, the buckling load also will increase. You may be underestimating also. See, whatever PCR you underestimate, you know, it is not, that may be underestimated from when you neglect the higher order terms. But the problem is when you include the higher order terms, you will see, maybe in 2 hour classes, that you will get, you know, beautiful equations, elliptical integrals will come into picture. Okay, so how to calculate elliptical integrals, you know, is an issue. Just wait for 2-3 classes where we'll do the complete derivation of the entire, you know, the large deflection, the large deformation. Okay. So it may be underestimating. Now, any other questions? Okay. So we'll go back to this one. So now, you know, to just summarize, you know, you would have already seen, right? So both ends fixed column. Now, all of you know, right? All these things you would have derived in your UG, like, you know, both the ends are fixed. What is the critical buckling load? You know, no? That effective length and others you would have seen. You know, you write the equation, right? EI y double dash, say, okay? Plus P times Y, you write it as M naught kind of a thing. And all of you know, you can see in your undergraduate textbook. So y is equal to some a sine, you know, kx plus b cos, you know, kx plus m naught by p kind of a thing. So you use the boundary conditions and others. All of you know the critical buckling loads. The lowest one is, you know, 4 pi square, you know, ei by, you see, l square kind of a thing. And then y, the buckling mode shape is, you know, m naught by p. 1 minus, you know, the cos 2 pi x by L. Okay, so these for the both the ends fixed, you know, you can easily derive yourself. Then for cantilever, say. So now for a cantilever column also, you would have already derived in your undergraduate, okay? So the load is here, so all of you know, so the deflection will be something like this. So the equation of equilibrium, say, so EI y double dash plus P times Y is equal to P times delta. So this is your delta at this free end. And then you see the buckling, that equation, eigenvalue equation is cos scale is equal to 0. And y is equal to the buckling mode shape, say, 1 minus cos pi x by 2L kind of a thing. And finally, the buckling load, PCR, is pi square EI by, I think, you know, 4L square. So this is for the cantilever column. Then, you know, for fixed ends, say, one end fixed and the other end hinged. Okay. So now for this case, also, all of you know, this is our equilibrium, EI y double dash plus PY is equal to M naught into X by L. Okay, you know, it's a, you know, the speciality of this is, you know, it's an inhomogeneous equation for fixed end and hinged. then for cantilever, then for even, you know, the both the ends fixed, you know, the ordinary differential equations are not homogeneous. You have a right hand side, there is a right hand side. So the buckling equation says, so that is a tan KL is equal to KL. And KL, the roots will be, say, 4.99, I think the first root or something like that. And critical buckling load, say, is, you know, 20.2 EI by L square. And your effective length, all of, you know, so this is, I think, some 0.7 times, you know, the L, okay? So only thing is, for simply supported case, for simply supported case, the, you know, why everybody likes simply supported, the reason is, you know, your right hand side is zero. It is a homogeneous equation actually, okay, where we have written, yes. So this is our equation for simply supported, okay, because your right hand side is zero, it is very easy to solve actually. But now when you change this boundary conditions, say, okay, so now you can see everywhere for the fixed end, say, you can see right hand side is not zero. Then for cantilever also, you see your right hand side is not equal to zero. Then for fixed and hinged case, say, here also, you see your right hand side is not equal to zero. So these are problems. So solving homogeneous ODE is very easy, but solving, you know, inhomogeneous kind of a case, you know, right, all of, like, you know, particular integral, you know, that solution, all the complementary solution has to be taken care, and you have to derive this buckling loads. And all of, you know, I think the effective length, you know, 0.7 L, then L by 2, then 2 times L also, you know, you would have studied in your undergraduate kind of a thing. Then you would also, some of you would have seen this, some of you would have even seen this beam columns also. So beam columns also you would have derived in your undergraduate, okay? So that you have, you know, like, you see, you know, so you have some type of a load, that is some Q of X, and you have this P, then, you know, the load P. Now all of, you know, when you have, when you include lateral, this load also, say, so now our, you know, the equation becomes, you know, dm by dx, you can derive taking a free body diagram and you can solve. So p into dy by dx is equal to some minus v kind of a thing you have. Finally, you know, after doing all those things, you can derive a fourth order equation actually, y fourth order plus, say, p y double dash, okay, is equal to, say, q of x. So this you can derive easily, you know, you draw the free body diagram and, you know, it is available in the textbooks itself, you can try. It becomes a fourth order, okay, something like a more, you know, the generalized case. So this is the equation of, you see, the equilibrium when you are having a beam column. That means, you know, you have a load also on the, you know, the lateral side, and you have this P, the fourth order ODE also comes. Okay, so now this also, you see, so we can write nicely, you know, you can YIV plus, you know, so K square Y double dash is equal to Q of X, and K say, K square is equal to, say, P by EI kind of a thing you have. Okay. So this becomes, you see, a fourth order equation. Suppose if Q of X is zero, then anyway it collapses to the previous case. Then, you know, we write, like, you see, the fourth order equation. K square is Y double dash is, you know, zero kind of a thing. So now, you know, so you can solve. So this also is a homogeneous equation. It's a more generalized case. Okay. The homogeneous equation here, and you can solve easily. See, the only advantage when you do with the previous equations, say, for, you know, the this fixed or this cantilever, you have inhomogeneous equations, but all these equations are second order ODEs. But if you write this type of equations, the equation is fourth order, but it is basically homogeneous for all, you know, the boundary conditions. And the only thing is, a fourth order ODE, four conditions are required here. But in second order, you require two boundary conditions, but you have to pay a price because your right hand side is not zero. But here, right hand side is zero, but the boundary conditions are four actual. Okay, so you can solve by this, or you can solve by this. You will more or less, you know, you will get, you see, the same type of answers itself. Okay, so this we will see in great detail, you know, in our next class. So our flow will be, in next class, we will see this fourth order ODE. Then we will go to that large deflection, as some of you have asked, right? Y dash and the energy also, okay? So that we will discuss, and then, you know, we'll proceed forward for other classes, okay? So with this, I will stop. Almost it is 12:50. Is it fine? Yes. Yes, now you can see me, right?
Yes.
Okay, so I think it's
yes.
Fine.
Yes.
So if you have any questions or anything, you can send me by email, or I think we have a WhatsApp group, right? You can post there also if you have any doubts or something. The textbooks will be sent to you by email by TAZ, Meenakshi. She will contact you and then she will send our textbooks also. It's, everything is available online. Okay. And if you have any doubts or anything, so you can post it in WhatsApp or you can send it in email itself. Or maybe during the class itself, you can ask. Fine.
Yes.
And I think we will follow the slot timings, okay? Because I think you may be having so many other classes, clashes may come actually, okay? And if you are unable to attend also, as the video will be available in Microsoft Teams, okay? All our videos are saved in ICS, that cloud website. You can log in and you can see, watch these videos also once again, okay? So fine then. So then I am closing our discussion right now, okay? Okay.